Welcome to the live service from Family Worship Center. This service is also being broadcast live on Sun Life Radio, online worldwide at sunlifetv.com, and on the free SBN app. We'll have praise and worship from the Family Worship Center singers and musicians, a time for prayer, plus the anointed preaching from God's Word. Now let's go live to the Family Worship Center sanctuary as this service begins.
Get ready to worship the Lord.
power.
Oh yeah,
wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Sing and there is power.
Power.
Oh yeah, wonder-working
power in the blood.
I know it's in the blood.
Of the
precious Lamb of God. There is power.
Power.
Wonder-working
power in the
See, the 100th Psalm says to enter his gates with thanksgiving, to enter his courts with praise, to give him thanks and to bless his name, y'all. So I'm not ashamed to say that I'm gonna clap my hands,
my hands.
And I'm gonna stomp my feet,
my feet.
And I'm gonna shout. Thank you for that power.
Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
And indeed, we enter your gates with thanksgiving this morning. You are a holy Lord and worthy of our thanks and praise. found. Oh Lord, I know, yes I do, where I belong. Oh, yes I do.
There is a spirit of praise and worship in here this morning. I mean, you could sense it the moment you walked in. There is a spirit of praise and worship. When Brian began to sing that old chorus, there's power in the blood.
Oh, yes.
I felt it run through my veins. I felt it run through this auditorium. And I want the world to know there's still power in the blood of Jesus. There's still power to save and to heal and to deliver. In the name of Jesus, come on, let's give Jesus Christ a hand clap of praise. Amen. I believe that you came with a heart of expectancy, that whenever we come expecting, God's going to do something.
Yes, yes,
I believe that He's going to do something great for us here this morning.
Yes.
I believe that souls are going to be saved and lives are going to be changed. I believe sick bodies are going to be healed. I believe that bondages will be broken. I believe that doubt will turn into faith. And I believe that in the name of Jesus. Come on, let's give God one more hand clap of praise. Why don't you turn around and shake some hands and welcome your neighbor here to the service this morning. We want to welcome each and every single one of you with us that are joining us around the world. Welcome to the platform of Family Worship Center right here in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We're so glad to have you joining us here today. Hallelujah. Man, I tell you, we're going to have some church this morning. How many of you came this morning with a need? All of us did. You're in the right place. Because where two or three are gathered in my name, he said, I will be in the midst. And I know that this morning he is present with us here today. Amen. How many first-time visitors would you slip up your hand? First-time visitors? Why don't you stand, all of our first-time visitors? Why don't you stand and let's welcome our visitors with us this morning? As the ushers are going about, they're going to give you a first-time visitor's packet. Make sure that you fill it out and detach it. And whenever we drop off the tithes and the offerings in just a few moments, march around and drop off that into the bucket. And now that service has begun, make sure all of us here, turn off all of our cell phones. So that means ladies, dig into your purse. Guys, dig into your pocket. And if you have a cell phone, make sure that you turn it off or put it in the silent position. Bible-thon is right around the corner. Our next October Bible-thon. Our goal for the month of October is to, for a total of 36,473 Expositors Outreach Bibles to be placed in the hands of pastors in third world countries. And here's where we are. Philippines, we need 19,687 English outreach Bibles. For El Salvador, 500 Spanish outreach Bibles. Argentina, 4,286 Spanish Expositors Outreach Bibles. And Guatemala, 12,000 Spanish Expositors Outreach Bibles. And as you can see, we've got our work cut out for us. But we are believing God for great and mighty things here today and for that upcoming Bible-thon that will be October the 3rd, and which is right around the corner. And if you can help us with the phones, if we can have some volunteers to help us with the phones, it would be greatly appreciated. If you can give us about 3 hours of your time, we would appreciate it very, very much. I want to say something regarding our Relief Center that we are still we're still out there, back there, working each and every single day. I want to say a big thank you to all of our volunteers and those that are helping regarding this event. This was not an easy thing to do. This was a major, major event. And we could not have done it without our volunteers. And I want us to thank our volunteers right now for their help regarding their relief center. Amen. There are still a lot of hurting people. And over this past few weeks, especially within the last week and a half, 2 weeks, we're starting to see people come in that are just now hearing about it. And we are just thankful that we have an opportunity to help families in need in our community. And I like to say it this way, the rains may have come, but we have gathered together in this city to make our city whole once again. And out of the ashes, Baton Rouge is going to rise back up. I believe that. We're going to be opening. Of course, the schedules are going to change a little bit. We're opening on Saturdays from 12 p.m. to 4 p.m. And how many Saturdays we're going to continue to be open will depend on the response that we get. So we still have a lot of clothing available and supplies available. Now, supplies are minimal, but we do have supplies left available. So if you need something, please go back to the Hogan Building and make sure that you take advantage of what we have. Once again, the last rally for my dad will be October the 28th in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. So all of you Oklahomites, go out and be with my dad, the singers and the musicians, October 28th at the Civic Center Music Hall, the Thelma Gaylord Performing Arts Center. Doors open at 6. Service will begin at 7. All seats are free, and we want you to be a part. Before we read our media members, we want to welcome in one special brand new member in regarding a baby dedication this morning. I want the parents of Hannah Nicole Mendito to come. This is dear friends Jesse and Mariah. They're coming right now to dedicate to the Lord Hannah Nicole Mendito. Papa.
I love to dedicate babies. And we've got a young lady here that's no longer a baby. We've got a young man here that's no longer a baby. And oh, this one is so pretty, as they all are. Yes, they are. Now settle down, little tiger. He's going to make an evangelist as sure as the world. You've heard me say this any number of times, but you hold the eternal destiny of these children in your hands. Think about that. Whether they spend eternity in eternal hell or eternal heaven, because the Word of God says if we raise them in the way they should go, when they get older, they won't depart from it. Could you bow your head, please, and say after me, Heavenly Father, by the grace of God and your help, your leading and guidance, we will guide these children in the paths of righteousness according to your word, but we cannot do it without your help. And we say it all in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now come here, sweetie, come here. Love, yeah, boy. Yeah, you're a little doll. Yes, you are. You want the microphone like all women. You want to. Heavenly Father, as we bring this beautiful young lady before you today, we pray blessings upon her of every description, that she'll always know the grace and the glory of God, and never the bondages of darkness, but always the Lord Jesus Christ. And now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we do dedicate Hannah Nicole Mendito to the grace and glory of God, and say it all in Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. You've got a beautiful family. The Lord bless you. Praise God.
All right. We want to welcome this morning 85 brand new members to the Family Worship Center Media Church. Go ahead, give the Lord a hand clap of praise on that one. From Alabama, Joshua. From Arizona, Arcelia and John. From Arkansas, Phyllis. From California, Bernice, Blanca, Christian, Gilbert, John, Melanie, Preston, Reuben and Victoria. From Connecticut, Joyce. From Florida, Eleanor and Roger. From Georgia, Kathy, Robin, and Travis. From Hawaii, Remy. From Idaho, Maria. From Illinois, Archie. From Indiana, Amy. From Kentucky, Jeremy. From Louisiana, Shirley. From Maryland, Patrick. From Massachusetts, Maria and Juanetta.
And from Michigan, Brenda, Glenn, Keith, Lynn, Sherry. From Minnesota, Dwyatt, Holly. From Mississippi, Roger. From Missouri, Jeremy, Kim, Sadie. From New Jersey, Jeff, Pamela, Patricia. From New York, Barbara, Brenda, John, Terry, Teresa. From North Carolina, Jonathan, Mildred, Vicky. From Ohio, Darlene, Douglas, Earl, Catherine, Tony. From Oklahoma, Lori, William. From Pennsylvania, Harold, Gene, Kelly, Renee, Ron. From South Carolina, Gary, Vito. From Tennessee, Brian, Teresa. From Texas, Aldolfo, Adriana, Barbara, Condilera, Dolores, Glenda, Karen, Martha, Mary, Mike, Pam, Ronnie, Ruth, Sherry, Vicky, Washington, Louise, Wisconsin, Mona, Sharon, and from the United Kingdom, Primrose. And let's stand, everybody. Let's give a great, big, hearty, warm welcome to our new media church members. We're so thrilled to have them. Thank the Lord.
Amen. Don't miss the service tonight. 6 o'clock. We're going to have a great time. Brother Bob Cornell is going to minister. So if you like and enjoy the ministry of Brother Bob Cornell as I do, then you need to be here tonight. You don't want to miss another great service. Family Worship Center, Resurrection Choir and Singers.
Thank you.
time it's glory, glory. Oh, hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down, I said it's glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down. You know, you don't have to carry those burdens. The scripture says, cast all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Glory to God. Well, it's glory, glory.
Hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down, it's glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down,
well, yes, I'm feeling so much better.
Since I lay my burden down,
said I'm feeling so much better.
Since I lay my burden down,
come on, come on. One more time. I can remember the first time I ever heard it. I was in, of all things, Jerry Lee Lewis's home. And I don't know where in the world he got this at. I have no idea. He had just bought a record player, and they just brought him out to where you could hear the bass. You could hear whatever the case. He put on that CD. No, it wasn't a CD. They didn't make CDs then. What did they make then? I'm just testing y'all. I'm just saying. It was a 45. No, it was a 33. 33 is about that big around. 45 about that big around. You know, Sam said the other day, she looked at her dad, brought out one of those big 33s. She said, Daddy, that's the biggest CD I've ever seen. And he put on that song, and it was in one of the AA Island meetings. I think it was from Phoenix, Arizona. And they began to sing. It's glory, glory. Hallelujah. Oh, since I lay my burden down. Oh, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Oh, 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 oh. since I lay my burdens down. The Jerry Lee's mother, my mother's sister, was an old-fashioned, Holy Ghost-filled lady. And whenever she'd get happy, she'd shout, and that song began to come across that little record player. And she began to praise God. Well, I'm glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I lay, hey, 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 my burdens down. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down. Yes, glory, glory. To the Lamb. Well, yes, I feel it. Just like shouting. Since I lay my burdens down. Yes, I feel it. Oh, just like shouting. Since I lay my burdens down. Now, I said I wasn't going to do this, but I'm going to do it. We're going to sing it one more time. And every one of you by television, it may be a burden of finances. It may be physical. It may be spiritual. It may be whatever. But you can lay it down today. Jesus said, cast your care upon me, for I care for you. Glory to God. And I mean just spiritually lay it down. Well, it's glory, glory.
Hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down.
Said I'm feeling. If you need prayer, I want you to come, because we still believe the Lord heals the sick. We still believe that He delivers and sets the captive free. Jesus is the sweetest name I know.
Helps in my troubles go through.
today that Satan did not have his way. For he tried to kill our brother, but he's alive and the father of it. And I'm asking that you would give to Jim everything that he's lost, plus. And we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Praise God. In the name of the Lord. Praise God. Father, in the name of Jesus, touch my brother. In the name of the Lord. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your power, for your healing, delivering virtue. I ask in the name of Jesus that every person who stands here today, every person by television, by the internet, by satellite, by radio, wherever they may be in this world, that your power, your power will flow onto them and into them and set that captive free. We ask it all in the mighty and the holy name of Jesus. Lord, giving you praise and glory. Amen and amen. Well, glory. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Where the healing waters flow. Where Incidentally, my little great-granddaughter, Cece, is on speaking terms with me again. She came up to me this morning, and I didn't know what she was doing. She held it out. I looked at her. I hugged her neck. She didn't say anything. Stuck her fingers up there. Come to find out, she had just put nail polish on her fingernails. That's like the lady that told her husband, she said, "You won't love me anymore that my hair is gray." He said, "Honey, I loved you when it was auburn, when it was brown, when it was black, when it was blonde. Why shouldn't I love you when it's gray?" I'm in trouble. Shut up, Robert. Just hush your mouth. Well, it's good to see you today. And we thank the Lord for his blessings so very, very, very much. Kim, are you ready to sing? Praise God. Thank you.
Jesus,
righteous and holy.
Jesus,
Lion and the Lamb.
Jesus,
faithful and worthy, great I am.
Oh, what a name, Jesus,
gracious Redeemer. Why look for another when you
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Kim, I want you to sing that last chorus. There's coming an hour that every tongue shall confess, every knee shall bow to Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Thank God I have already bowed, and I will forever bow to His presence.
Jesus, oh, what a name, my Jesus, oh, what a name. Yesterday, today, forever the same. For the one who never changes,
changes everything.
Praise God, praise God. Thank you, Kim. What a name. And they shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let's receive the tithe and the offerings for the church today, and I thank you so much for your giving. I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank all of you by television, radio, internet, satellite, wherever in the world you are, for praying for us and for standing behind this ministry. And we pray God's richest, richest blessings upon each and every one of you. Could you stand, please? Heavenly Father, I thank you today, dear Lord. Thank you for these people, not only here in this sanctuary, but those around the world. I thank you for the help that they give under your guidance and your leading. And I'm asking for your richest blessings. You said, Lord, my blessings will chase you down. You said, I'll open the windows of heaven, praise God. And Lord, I'm asking you to do that In the mighty name of Jesus, and everyone said amen and amen. Could I get you to come, please? Well, Jesus, hold my hand. I need
the every hour.
There's a song that I used to sing a long, long time ago, and Francis brought it back to my attention just a short time ago. It says, "Oh, search me, oh God, and know my heart. Today try me, oh Savior, know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be some wicked way in me. Oh, cleanse me from every sin and set me free. I thank for cleansing me from sin, fulfill, O Lord, your word, and make me pure within. Oh, fill me, oh, with fire, where once I burned with shame. Thank you. my life. Oh, and make it holy thine. Fill my poor heart with your great love divine. Take all my will, my passion, myself, and pride. I now surrender, O Lord, this day in me. Sing that last verse. Sing it with me now. Oh, Holy Spirit, revival comes from thee. Send, O Lord, revive and start that work in me. For blessing, blessing now, oh Lord, oh Lord, I humbly plead for blessing. Blessing now, oh Lord, oh Lord, I humbly, humbly plead.
Why don't you just worship him right now? Just stretch forth your hands. Make this song your daily prayer. Search me, O God. We pray that you would search us. Help us to be more like you. Hallelujah. What a song. What a song. If you have your Bibles this morning, I want you to turn with me to the New Testament book of the Gospel of St. Mark. And I promise you I will not hold you too long. Mark chapter 4. Trying to find it. It's on page 1719. Mark chapter 4, beginning in verse 35. And the same day when the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto them, Master, carest thou not we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. Hallelujah. Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And I want to use for a subject preaching just for a few moments this morning. The words of Christ, let us pass over to the other side. There's a great meaning in that statement. And I help with the help of the Holy Spirit, I pray that we would bring that out here today. Let us pass over to the other side. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I thank you for your presence that has been in this place today. I pray that you would anoint us to minister and anoint our ears to hear what you would have us say. And Lord, if we may be going through a trial or tribulation, we hold to that word, let us pass over to the other side. Lord, I ask that you would ever help us to decrease as you would ever increase. And we ask it in the mighty name of Jesus. And the church said, amen and amen. Doubt never sees God, even when he is in your midst. But faith always sees God, irregardless of the situation you might be in. Now, I want you to get that here this morning. Doubt never sees God, even when he is in your midst. But faith always sees him, irregardless of the situation that you may be in. You see, whenever you go through a trial or tribulation, of which we will deal with here this morning, when you doubt, you say, God, I don't know if you're able. When you doubt, you say, God, I'm not sure if you're able to see me through. But faith says, regardless of what situation I may be in, God, you are going to see me through to the other side. You are going to see me through to the other side. Now, I want that to sink in here today. Doubt never sees God, but faith always sees him. Faith says God can. Faith says God is able. Faith said that there is nothing impossible for God. Faith says that to this mountain be thou removed. Faith says to that Red Sea, part and they will part. Faith will say to that rock, come water out of it, and water will come out of that rock. Faith says with God all things are possible. With God all things are possible. Just to have seen it, just to have been there. There was never a man like this man. Never a man walked the earth like this man. Oh, I feel that. Never a man spoke like this man. For when he spoke, power came through. With a word, he can heal the sick. But I feel faith in this place this morning. With a word, with one spoken word, miracles could be performed. Never a man walked on the water but this man. Just to have
gotten a glimpse of Jesus of Nazareth, the crowds would gather. They were hanging on every word that he would say. Never a man taught like this man. Never a man preached like this man. They pressed in, thousands upon thousands, to the point where he would have to place himself in a boat. Just to have seen what these people saw. And as he would speak, he would teach in parables. I honestly believe that he would teach in parables for those that were just passing by, or those who were just had just some sort of a thought about him, that when speaking in parables, they would move on. But for those who hungered and thirst after righteousness, they would be filled. And he began to speak all day, teaching, expounding on the word of God. Miracles were performed. Everyone watched what this man called Jesus of Nazareth would say, what he would do. How many of you would have loved to have been there to see that, to hear him speak? Hour after hour, as the words would flow through his lips, power would flow through them. Once again, I want this to sink in. Never had a person spoke like this before, that with his word, power could be felt. There was an anointing to those words and an anointing upon him that no one had ever felt or seen. A man full of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. A man full of the Holy Spirit. Power. An anointing. Set the captive free. Those that were sick would long for him just to reach out and touch him. Those who were vexed longed for him to reach out to touch him. Those who were in need longed for him to stretch forth his hand and touch them. For they knew that if they can just touch him, or if he can touch them, their need could be met. I want that to sink into every single one of you here. I don't care who you are, and I don't care what the problem may be. There's never been a problem that he could not solve. There's never been a problem he could not fix. If you can just reach out and touch the very hem of his garment, you shall be made whole. And thank God, if he doesn't touch you, you can touch him. Hallelujah. If he doesn't touch you, you can reach out and touch him. Exhaustion would set in. Now I know as God, he never gets tired. But as a man, he grew tired and weary like we do. An hour after hour of teaching and ministering and healing the sick and performing miracles, exhaustion would set in. To the point where the disciples would have to carry him into a larger vessel. And he would speak to those disciples as they gathered in that vessel. And he would tell them, let us pass over to the other side. Now that, as I mentioned that phrase, there's a weight and wealth of meaning to that statement. It has so much more to do than just going from one seashore to the next. But it speaks of the reason of which Christ would come. You see, in the next chapter, in Mark chapter 5, Mark would record of a man, a demoniac from Gadara, living amongst the tombs. Stones, he would use stones to cut his flesh. No amount of bonds would keep him, for he would snap out of them. But yet when he said, let us pass over to the other side, it speaks of the reason why he came. Because there were hurting souls just like this one man, this demoniac from Gadara. There were hurting souls, and there was only one way for him to come and to touch them. You see, that man could not get to Jesus. That demoniac from Gadara could not get to Jesus. So he went to him. Oh, hallelujah. He could not get to Jesus, so Jesus would come to where he was. Likewise, we could not get to Jesus, so he came to us. He came to us. He came to us. We couldn't reach out to him, so he reached down for me. That old song, when my Savior reached down for me. When he reached way down for me, I was lost and undone without God or his son. When he reached down his hand for me, glory to God, he reached his hand down for me. He reached his hand down for you. And lost in your sins and shame, bound by sin and on your way to hell, Jesus stopped what he was doing and came to where you were. Do you feel that? I feel that this morning. When my Savior reached down for me, when he reached way down for me, I was lost and undone without God or his son when he reached down his hand for me. And when I reached up and grabbed that nail-scarred hand, at that very moment, I can say, gone at last. Gone at last. My sins are gone at last. I had a long streak of that bad, bad time, but my sins are gone at last. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. He reached down his hand, and I grabbed a hold of that hand, and he's going to lead me out of this with his nail-scarred hand. Hallelujah. That's the reason why he came. He came for you. He came for me. He came for you. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what you're involved in. Jesus came to you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Every single one of us in this auditorium and every one of us watching and listening, we were on our way to hell, and some of us should be there right now. But Jesus reached down for me. Jesus reached down and picked me up. He reached down, way down for me. It speaks of the reason of which he came. For you see, in just a moment's time, that demoniac of Gadara, out of his mind, insane, demon-possessed, will be clothed and in his right mind. And as Papa would say, he became an evangelist, the evangelist of Gadara, spreading the good news of Jesus. You see, have you ever thought about this? Every time a person comes to Jesus Christ and they are saved, they become an evangelist. Meaning that they can't wait to tell somebody what Jesus Christ has done for them, and that what he did for them, he can do for you as well. But there was a second reason to that statement, and I'll get to it in just a moment. They board that vessel. Jesus falls asleep. The Bible says that evening had come. What should have been a routine trip turned into a nightmare. the disciples, as they boarded that vessel and set sail, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, blackness, dark clouds filled the sky. Thunder began to roll. The wind began to blow. The waves begin to grow. Sheets of rain begin to pelt down upon them. You can see that electric fork of lightning pierce through the sky and light up that night sky. The thunder would be so loud, the crashing of the waves upon that boat, to the point that boat was being tossed to and from. Water began to fill the boat. Now let me tell you something. I've only been in a few boats in my life. I'd rather, much rather, have my feet on land. But I cannot imagine what it would be like if you're in the middle of the ocean or the middle of a sea and all of a sudden a hurricane-like force winds, with waves crashing down upon you. I've only seen too many shows on TV showing that. I don't want to dare try my luck with that. But I could not imagine the fear that would grip my life and my mind and my heart as I was experiencing something of that magnitude. But you see, that storm that they were going through was a type of the storms that you and I will face as a Christian. You see, this storm, they did not expect it. It came out of nowhere. Just as in life, there were storms that will happen to you and will happen to me that will take us by surprise. Things that will happen that will literally pull the rug out and from underneath us, and we don't really know why it happened or what's going on, and you question why this is taking place. But every single one of us, no matter how close to God you are, the closer to God you may be, the harder the trials may be. Faith has to be tested. And great faith must be tested greatly. Now, in my opinion, I know the devil couldn't do anything to Jesus. But if he could kill one or two of the disciples, this storm was sent as a test of faith for the disciples. Just as the storms that you will go through and endure is a test of your faith. The last several weeks that I've preached here from Family Worship Center, that's what I have dealt with, the testing of our faith. Satan will try to tempt you to destroy your faith, whereas God tests you to strengthen your faith. Remember that. And every one of us will experience difficulties and storms where fear literally grips us. We question why. We don't know why that this is taking place. Some of those storms take place because of our own stupidity. But others, God orchestrates or allows it to take place. Everything, now I've said this 100 times, but bear with me. Everything that happens to you as a believer, God has either caused it or he has allowed it to happen. And at times, God will allow Satan leeway to come against you, to show you what is inside of you, to show you just how big of a God that he really is. But also to show you that you're not as holy as you think you are. Come on now. But I want to go back to that statement. Jesus did not tell his disciples, "Let us get into this boat, get halfway there, and perish." He said, "Let us go to the other side." The second meaning to that statement is this: if Jesus is in your boat. If Jesus is in your boat. If Jesus is in your boat, regardless of the storms that come, you are going to make it. You're going to make it. You're going to make it. The storms will come, but you're going to make it. The winds will blow, but you're going to make it. Storms will come, but you will make it. Glory to God. He said, let us pass over to the other side. Tell the devil, devil, do what you will. But my God has already stated, I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it. Church, you're going to make it. Have you ever noticed how many people has God ever lost? None. So if he hasn't lost any, what makes you believe that he'll lose you? The devil will be very good at telling you you're going down with the ship. But you just tell the devil, devil, you're not in my boat. My Lord, I feel that. You're not in my boat. I've got somebody in my boat that is the greatest man who's ever walked this earth. I've got someone in my boat who can just speak the word and the peace can be still. I've got Jesus in my boat. And with Jesus in my boat, I am going to make it. Glory to God. I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it. Just tell the devil, devil, I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it. I'm not sinking. I'm going through. I'm going to make it. Oh, my Lord, I feel that. I'm going to make it. The devil will tell you, he's very good at telling you that I'm going to do you in. I'm going to destroy you. I'm going to make sure that your family leaves you. I'm going to make sure that this happens and that happens and this happens and that happens. But you have rest assured. Have the assurance to know, devil, you are not my captain, but God is my captain. Jesus is my captain, and I'm going to make it through to the other side. Believe that. Believe that. No, there are no takebacks in this. There's no going backwards in this. You're in the middle of that storm right now, and I know it's hard. I know it's difficult to go through and endure. And at times you feel like you're just wading in water with your head just barely above the water. But you see, Jesus is walking on the water. I see somebody walking. I see somebody walking. I see somebody walking that if I just hold my hand out, he will pick me up and see me through to the other side. It speaks of the fact that you are going to make it. I want you to believe that. Leave this building and say, devil, I'm going to make it. Devil, I'm going to make it. In spite, you see, I want to go back to what I said a moment ago. Doubt says, God, I don't think so. Some of you may have walked into this church house this morning saying, God, I don't know how you're going to do it. I don't know if you can do it. But God is sending this word your way to let you know if you just hold out and believe him, you are going to make it. You're going to make it. He's going to see you through to the other side. The disciples were panicking. Understandable, I would have been too. And all of us find ourselves in that position of panic. But Jesus was asleep. Think about that. Everyone was panicking and Jesus was asleep. Sometimes he waits for the right moment. He waits for the right moment. You see, they've done everything they knew to do. They got those buckets and were trying to get that water out of that ship. And they thought that they were going to die. I mean, they literally thought they were going to perish, because that's when they walked. They had nothing else to do. They have done everything. Then they finally decided, Jesus is in the boat. Let's go wake him up. He walks down. They walk down and they cry out, Master, don't you care that we perish? Have you ever said that? Lord, don't you know? Don't you know? They woke him up. Their cries awakened the master. And he steps out from his sleep, steps out to the front of that boat. Now, I want you to listen to this. The Bible says that as he stood, he cried, peace be still. But in the Greek manuscripts, the inference is that before a word was even spoken, by the mere power of his will, the laws of nature were changed. Come on. I was reading this in the commentary, and I sat there and I read that. And when I read that, I about had a shouting camp meeting in my little office at the house. He said in the Greek, before the word was even uttered, that by the power of his will, that the very power of his, but I hope some of you will get this, by the very power of his will, before a word was uttered, the moment he stepped out on the scene, I mean the very moment that his foot touched the front of that ship and started walking out, the winds and the waves begin to cease and die down. Glory to God. They saw who was coming. They saw who was coming. They saw who was coming. The devil sees who's coming. He may destroy you, but he sees who is coming. By his very will, the laws of nature changed. And then he shouted. He didn't just sit there and say, peace. But I believe there was a look of fierceness in his eyes as the devil set out to destroy his people. And he looked the devil right smack dab in the eyelids and said, peace. Peace, silence, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up, silence, hush, peace. Have you ever been around somebody that won't stop talking? I mean, they talk 90 miles an hour. You wonder if they can even breathe. They're talking so much. And you finally get to the point where you just had it. And you just lose it. And you look at them and say, shut up. Startled. And they don't know what to do. Jesus told the devil, shut up! Shut up! Oh, that's a bad word. I know it is, but you get my point. God, Jesus looked at the winds and the waves and said, peace, silence, hush, shut up! Then he said, be still. You know what that means? To muzzle to put up, have you ever had a rabid dog you had to put a muzzle on it? I've never seen that. I've just seen it on TV. But you put that muzzle on it. It silences it. Never to do it. Shut up. I'm going to muzzle you. Silence. Peace be still. And the Bible says instantly. Instantly. It didn't just die down. You know, have like you're in the middle of a song, and I probably shouldn't say this, but all right, y'all forgive me, okay? Y'all just don't look at me any different, okay? Please. About a decade ago, I told my grandfather, I said, Papa, I said, you know, I've never seen Jerry Lee perform. Of course, he performed before my time. And I said, I'd like to see him before he stops or he retires. He called and got me in. He was in Mississippi somewhere. Me and Jill and Carolyn and Jennifer went, and I got there early, so I got a chance to spend some time with him and talk to him. And when I walked in, there was a group of people there, and he just looked up and said, is Jimmy's boy here? Jimmy's boy, is he here? Kind of raised my hand. He said, all right, everybody get out. Get out. And everybody's looking at me and looking at him, and he said, I told y'all, get out, go. So I'm sitting here in this room, and he says, you know, we started talking, had a great time with him. He's a nice guy. So we get out there, and he starts to perform. And I'm sitting there listening to this, and I'm thinking, this is like a world. I'm not used to this. I mean, it was, I think the venue sat about 2,000 people. I think there was 4,000 people jammed in there. I mean, everybody as old as Methuselah was out there. I'm kidding. I'm joking, please. And I mean, when he started playing, they started doing whatever, and I'm just looking around like, wow. And in the middle of a song, I mean, he had sung this song, and right in the middle of it, he just stopped playing. And the band just went, he said, I've been singing that song for 50 years. I'm tired of singing it. I'm never singing it again. But you know how sometimes that music just kind of died? This didn't happen this way. The very moment that Jesus uttered the word, it had already begun to silence. It had already begun to stop. I'm talking, it was instantaneous. You see, you've got someone that is inside of you that is able to say, peace, be still in the middle of your storm. When that happens, it was calm. Calm. You're going to go through it. But as long as you keep your eyes on Jesus Christ, who he is and what he's done, he's never lost one. And he's not going to lose you. He's never lost one, and he's not going to lose you. As long as you hold on to the cross, church, he'll never let you go. As long as you hold on and believe, he's never going to let you go. He's going to make sure that you see safely to the other side. Amen. The storms will come. The winds are going to blow. Difficulties are going to arise. But as long as Jesus is in your boat, he said, let's pass over. Let us, not just himself, let us. You're going with him. You're going with him. The trio sings a song, I'm going to make it, because he's already said I would. And I want you to hold on that you are going to make it, because he's already said that you would. He's not going to turn you aside, and he's not going to let you go. But as long as you hold on, peace, he'll say, peace, be still. And he'll see you safely to the other side. Singers and musicians, come on back right now. Let me share with you how this came about. I had something else already prepared for this service. And And I was in the studio on Thursday morning, and all this week I've been taping pre-recording programs for the month of October for my program, Living Waters. And as I was going through the music, I was picking out the songs, and I was looking for a trio song, and I was just kind of looking down the list, and I came across one. The title was Your Cries Have Awoken the Master. I asked him to play, and that was the first song that I played. And as I greeted the people on camera, this was pre-recorded, so it will air sometime next month. I began to share a little 5-minute synopsis of the message that I shared to you here this morning. And I begin to encourage the people that if Jesus is in your boat, your cries have awoken the Master, and He is going to see you through. I played that song, I mean, the presence of God came into that studio. I wept and I cried and I told the play, once it was finished, it was a little over 8 minutes long, and I said, play it again. I played it again because I felt someone needed to hear that song. And I've asked them to sing this little chorus, this song, real quick. Your cries have awoken the Master. And if you're here this morning, and I don't care who you are, and if you feel like you're in the midst of a storm and you don't know what to do, as they sing this song, I want you just to step out of your seat. And I'm going to ask all the brethren to come up here. I want all the brethren to come, and I want them to stand around this front. As the trio begins to sing it, if this is you and say, I'm in the middle of a storm, I don't know what to do, come on down to this front.
The disciples were getting concerned. The wind started violently blowing. But He was asleep in the stern.
Pastors, just start praying for them right now once they come. Just begin to lay hands on them right now and just begin to pray for them. You're going to make it.
Jesus arose when they called Him.
And said to them,
where is your faith?
Whatever the storm is.
But you wait all night.
Come on as close as you can to this one.
With all of your might.
Just stretch forth your hands right now and start declaring it, Lord. You're going to see me through. You're going to see me through. But the Spirit of God is right where you are. And if you're going through a storm right now, at this very moment, just stretch forth your hands and believe God He's going to see you through. You see no hope in the distance.
You're frightened
with nowhere to run.
And by now your vessel is filling. And you think
surely drown.
But you cried out for help.
You cried out. Cry out for help right
and you
now.
You know that you can't give up now.
Fast asleep. is so deep.
But try to be patient.
But be patient.
He'll soon bring peace.
One word from his voice.
And it all must cease.
It all cease. Come on, start praying right now.
Would you pray,
in the name of Jesus.
Would you hold on with all of your mind? Child, your life. Have a warm hand, the Master.
Cry out to him. Just for you, some of you listening, you're worried.
He's fast asleep. The winds are so deadly.
Winds are deadly.
The water's so deep.
Try to be patient.
But be patient. Soon he'll bring peace.
One word from his voice. Praise this morning. Come on, let's give him a hand clap of praise. You're going to make it. You're going to make it. You're not going down. You're going over. You're not going down. You're going through. You're going through to the other side. Raise your hands right now all across this auditorium. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you. I thank you that you're in my boat. I thank you that I'm going to make it through. You know the needs represented here from your people. And Lord, I'm asking that you would touch and minister. Meet every single need, that whatever the difficulty, faith says God is able. Faith says God is going to do it. Faith, we believe that God's going to see us through. Devil, you're not going to take us out. But we're going through in the name of Jesus. We rejoice believing that you're able. And we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise. I want you to leave here this morning believing that I'm going to make it. That I'm going through. That I'm going through. He paid the price, whatever others may do.
Hallelujah.
I'll take the way of my Lord's anointed few. I started out trusting Jesus,
and I'm going through. Come on, sing it right now.
Will Jesus hold my hand?
Jesus, hold my hand.
While I run this race.
Turn around and tell your neighbor you love him. Be back with us tonight, 6 o'clock. You don't want to miss another great Holy Spirit filled service. We love you. God bless you.
While I run this race.
We hope you were blessed and enjoyed this live service from Family Worship Center. Family Worship Center, located in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, at Jimmy Swaggart Ministries, holds 3 services weekly, Sunday at 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. Central Time, and Wednesday at 7 p.m. Central Time. All services are broadcast live on the Sun Life Broadcasting Network, including Sun Life Radio, online worldwide at sunlifetv.com, and on the free SBN app. To become a member of the Family Worship Center Media Church, call 1-800-288-8350 or join online at jsm.org. Live Family Worship Center services are produced by the Sun Life Broadcasting Network.